were hit head-on by a drunk driver. Got rolled round and round in the car. I got pregnant with our first child in China.
We really couldn't tell how it would be like.
It took me about 24 hours to get through on the phone once I'd had the baby.
I did not have a clue.
It was really hard.
That was a very, very complex moment for me in our relationship.
Koulibaly's family said no to our marriage.
I was actually doing a lot of negotiations.
I was very angry.
There was nothing I could do.
We met in China. I'd been there 1 week and I'd gone for a Chinese medicine practical, which was 3 months. And I went to the cafe and I thought, and I never do this normally, I thought, oh, I'll go and sit with those people, they look interesting. And so I went and sat, and there was Koulibaly with friends, and we just sort of talked, and then I left, and then I turned around and he was really looking at me and with very sparkly eyes. So then I thought, okay, you can do the rest. That was in September 1984, yeah. And there wasn't a lot of, there weren't a lot of foreigners visiting. So they were very looked after. They were very well looked after by the Chinese authorities. So I had finished my acupuncture training and I'd gone to China for clinical practice because that was the way to do it in those days.
I had absolutely no idea about how China is or what to expect. And I did not have any way of deciding. So all I did was, playing cards. I loved playing cards, played a lot. And my partner, Jim Marco, we were just putting down a card. I said, I received a funny letter today. He said, what is that? I said, well, you see, I got a scholarship to China. I don't know what to do. And he put his card down. He said, you better take that. And I said, okay, I'll take it. And that was how the decision was made, because I had no way of deciding. And from there onward, and then I spoke to my parents. And they say, well, we don't know much about China, so we have no objections. You make your decisions up. So that's how we decided, okay, we go.
So I got pregnant with our first child in China. And it wasn't a comfortable situation to give birth in China, not being married. I was supposed to throw myself down the well. Students weren't supposed to have relationships with one another. They were supposed to just be working, and it was socially conservative. And I mean, what people did sort of outside what they were supposed to do was just what everyone else does. The official line was that it was, yeah, conservative. You should be married if you're going to have a baby. So I went back to Australia. And Koulibaly stayed on because he had to finish. So I had our baby in Australia, and it took me about 24 hours to get through on the phone once I had the baby. And my family were very tolerant and they were excited.
It was a complex moment for us because we did not really know what to do. In a sense, we did not know what the future held for us. Being from Mali and Jenny being from New Zealand and living in Australia was quite complex. Even though Jenny's mom had visited us in Mali and some family friend from here had visited us in Mali.
In China.
Yeah. We really couldn't tell how it would be like. You see what I mean? And saying that as well, I mean, a multicultural couple in New Zealand, I did not have a clue how that was going to be accepted in this country. So I really didn't know what was going to happen. But I visited Jenny and Yakuba, her son, in Melbourne when he was 6 months. And after that, I went to finish my degree. And that was a complex period because should we live in Mali? Should we live in New Zealand? Or where do we live? Because immigration is always a complex issue to resolve. And the third country, which is Australia, made it even more complex to think about. But after spending 5 years in China, I really wanted to live in Mali. I was tired of being called a foreigner, to be honest with you. And I just wanted to be in Mali. At that period, I think when I visited him after a while, we had decided that we want to live in Mali. And Jenny was living in Australia, and she came to say goodbye to her parents.
We were hit head on by a drunk driver, and I was in the back. But our son was, I hadn't put a seatbelt on because our son was in the back too, and I wanted to, you know, kind of attend to him. So I got rolled round and round in the car, and he was saved because I'd gone like that. But I broke an arm and a leg, and I ruptured my spleen. So I was kind of hemorrhaging, and I was nearly died, and had to be resuscitated. And so that was really horrible. And someone in the car died. So that was my sister-in-law, so that was also really, really hard.
But now in New Zealand, and I'm in Mali, I had no idea how things were going. There was nothing I could do. And that was a very, very complex moment for me in our relationship.
What it did for our relationship straight away was, in a practical way, because I now didn't have a spleen, I was susceptible to malaria. And in New Zealand, the ACC system gave me a lump sum for loss of enjoyment of life because I couldn't go to Mali. Well, I could, but it would be risky and difficult. And frankly, it frightened me now because I thought, if I get malaria, I have to be really close to help, or it will overwhelm my body because I can't produce enough white blood cells to combat the malaria. So I was devastated because we were actually on our way to Mali and we had tickets. So it was really hard. And then we had an additional kind of complication because Koulibaly's family said no to our marriage. And my mum was like, yeah, whatever, you know, do what you want. But they said no. And so he really had to wait until they said yes. And at the time, I was very angry because I didn't understand what it meant to go against your whole family, because that's your identity and the family act as a whole in Mali. So it's very unusual to, you know, go against what the aunts and uncles are saying and So it was really hard because we had to wait until they turned around and said yes. And then it was only years after that I actually understood that, no, in the circumstances I would have done the same thing. But because being a Westerner and having an idea that, you know, we're autonomous, if our parents said no, we wouldn't take any notice anyway. So I didn't understand, and that made it complicated.
The family, the general step is negotiation. You negotiate with them. So I was actually doing a lot of negotiation, going to see my uncles and my aunties to intervene one way or another. And that's a general way you deal with it. Because you know that at first instance, the parents will be very angry. First, you had a child outside marriage. But in addition to that, it is a foreigner. They don't know exactly what it is like and nothing. So it was actually a normal negotiation process, which can be frustrating for someone who doesn't understand. But you know that ultimately, they are never going to let a grandchild go somewhere else. It will happen, but you have to just negotiate and go through it. In our society, it's not just a marriage between two people, it's a marriage between families. And that's one of the big questions from my dad was, are they worth our in-laws? And that was a very big question, which means that it's not just about between you two, it is between the two families. Can the two families get on well together?
And I made a big mistake because thinking that I was an autonomous Westerner, I wrote a letter to Koulibaly's dad on behalf of myself. And that was a total mistake. I mean, I think when I think about it now, I think, ah, God. And of course, then he was really angry. I gather.
Yeah, well, Dad was angry. He only told me one day, because I was working in a construction site, and for a weekend I was discussing. He said, Jenny sent me a letter. I said, well, yeah. But that was all I discussed with him about it. I didn't ask what was in the letter or anything. But it's later on that Jenny explained to me what was in the letter.
I was sort of selling myself in a way that I thought he would like. It was terrible. Well, you know, I come from a not honest, good family, and I'm not Muslim, but I could be a Sufi. crazy. Now, as soon as I go to Mali and I see, you know, how everyone is and the incredible tolerance of religion in Mali, I think, wow, that was really stupid just to make all these assumptions. It was only after a few years that I started to understand how complex it is in Mali and how important the two families coming together is. And when we went for our first visit, my mum came too. And when she arrived, everyone said, you guys, you're not important, she's important. Because she's come to say that she would like to have a relationship with our family. And she's come to us. So that actually had a very healing effect on everything, because I was quite scared to even talk to Kulibali's dad on the phone, because I was embarrassed at how I'd been so naive.
Yeah, the fact that Jenny's mum came to Mali with Jenny's cousin Mark, that was a really turning point in our relationship, because to the family, Jenny's mum was over 80, and that was a very important thing that an 80-year-old actually accompanied us. So that's why the most important person in the thing was her. And dad came to me one morning and said, son, you're right, we are with our in-laws. And I said, oh, okay. I had actually forgotten that question that he had asked me something like 6-7 years down earlier. And that was a very, very important, because it showed that our two families actually have a lot in common and we can have relationship. And that was really reflected back when we got to New Zealand and went to see Jenny's uncle in Christchurch. And Jenny's cousin had told him that the family had killed a sheep for us, or a goat, I can't remember anymore. And he did the same thing for me. And that was really interesting. And because the two families had a lot in common. We were both farmers. But the accident was really a turning point for everything for us, because it meant that we have to live here rather than living in Mali. And no matter what we do, we have to always keep the fact that Jenny doesn't have a spleen. We have to always keep that in our mind to say that we cannot take reckless risk. I may be able to say, yeah, I'm fine, I can live in Mali, but we have to always be conscious and say, can Jenny really do this physically, or in case of any malaria, what will happen?
Yeah, it's a drag.
It's a drag. So it really affected our relationship in a way that, not between us, but in a way we wanted to leave. All our planning were through the window. We literally was, we couldn't do any planning like that anymore. But it was great. Whatever God got for you, you have to go with that. Your planning is only what you wish to do. It's not something in concrete that you have to do.
And sometimes it took away our choices, but sometimes it's actually easy when your choices are taken away.
Well, a lot of the time, the reality of life just get over. You don't actually sit down and think, what about if it didn't happen? Because you know that no one did it. God did it, and that's why we have to take it. And at the same time, our kids, we had our second child, and now we have two children. So we had the reality of life to live, to deal with looking after children, and studies and work. Juggling that really didn't give us enough time to even think what we could do. But however, sometimes I do feel really homesick. I want to go to Mali, and that hurt me a lot. My grandma passed away. That really hurt me very, very hard, because I was very close to her and I was far away. There wasn't much I can do. And I felt really lonely here. We were only around 2 Malians living in New Zealand, as far as I knew. and that was quite hard. So being homesick then, Jenny's approach was very important because she came in and she said, look, I can see you are really homesick. We have to do something. And I couldn't see a way through. She said, no, we adopt one of your brothers or sisters. And I said, oh, okay. That is a possibility which will get rid of that issue or will help us. And at the same time, I felt it was hard for me because I didn't feel I was contributing much to the family in Mali as well. Because I felt that we all live together and we all have to contribute to the family. And being a student and just starting work, I didn't think I was contributing enough. And then when I went to Mali and then came with my brother, that was very helpful. I'm not sure how my brother felt about it because he was homesick as well. No, I had taken him away from all his friends. So sometimes I think he probably was resentful, but some other time he liked it because I put him in the same scenario that I was. But it did help our relationship a lot because then I felt that I was contributing to the family by having my brother here, and we helped him to get educated and so on, which he ended up staying just like me. So
I don't think it would have made us not stay together if we'd had more technology or less. It was just a given that we would stay together.
But at the same time, yeah, the technology hasn't made much difference on that. I don't believe it would have changed much. But I believe that our relationship, a commitment, came from when our parents were supportive. The two families were supportive. And then that make it, we feel supported. Because I felt that Jenny's family really supported me. Even when I had a problem with Jenny or we were arguing or anything like that. Jenny's mom was really supportive, and I loved that.
But she, at first, because being a Westerner, she'd go, oh, Boubacar, I don't know if I can interfere. I don't want to interfere. And he was going, please interfere, please. So then she would take his side to make him feel really good.
Well, it made me feel good anyway. Yes, I think that the two families' support made a big role in your relationship with my mom and the rest of the family as well.
Koulibaly's mother is just a very truly heartfelt person. So you can actually feel it in your body how she's coming from her heart all the time. So it makes everything very simple. And so when I think about Mali, it does feel a bit like home too. I just don't like those mosquitoes.
That's a problem, isn't it? Yeah. Well, I grew up in a village. I did not see a city until I was 17, even though the village is only 50 km from the city. So I was totally a village boy. And agriculture in terms of crops, millet, corns, beans, funios, peanuts, groundnuts, all sort of things we grow. But we had a lot of cows and sheep and goats. So it was in a lot of fruit trees. So it's just, that's how I grew up in terms of total agricultural land. But even now we got a farm, so we still really love it. And we certainly are like if we live in two countries at the same time. When I arrived in New Zealand, the first thing was I had a choice to go to Auckland University or Canterbury University. But Jenny's mom was in Christchurch. So we had an interview. I met my supervisor at Auckland University to do my Master of Engineering. And when we went to Christchurch, I said, okay, I think I will go to Canterbury University. And I remember Jenny crying that she didn't want to live in Christchurch. I said, what's wrong? Anyway, later on I understood because there were even fewer Africans in Christchurch, which means...
It was at Christchurch at that stage was so monocultural and and I knew that the children would be at best seen as a novelty, whereas in Auckland with huge Pasifika communities, Asian, you know, South Asian, East Asian, everything, it didn't matter.
It wasn't many of those at the time,
because the African were not too many of us either.
No, but it was just very, very much more diverse here
than Christchurch, yes, certainly. Yeah. It was quite small. We struggled to find one African soccer team. We used to play with Fijian. We had an African-Fijian soccer team together because there wasn't enough for an African team. Yeah, until the community grew slowly, slowly. It was quite hard, but it was, in a way, we all knew each other and we were much more supportive of each other at the time because we all had the same need. And that was a need of belonging. Yeah, the idea of the film festival came was in the African community, trying to unite Africans, trying to help because the community was growing. But the idea was really to share cultures with New Zealanders, to create more understanding. Because through one film, it gave a lot more than 100 TV reports. Because simply they would be looking through one little lens and one person saying what you think about it. And the filmmaker is showing the entire environment, talking about all good and bad. It doesn't select in between. It talks about everything. So doing films, festival, and covering the entire 54 countries as well as the diaspora is very, very helpful in people sort of understanding more about it. She's so supportive as well because through all that craziness, we are now doing, I think, the 8th edition. So she's now actually right always. A lot of a synopsis.
But I'm not a, you know, like I'm not a decision maker in it because I feel like it's very important that it's mostly African. Because New Zealand is small, I think it actually has an advantage in terms of diversity because people don't tend to ghettoise like they would in a big place. And so that does make for, officially, more tolerance. So I think it's a very good thing. And I think New Zealand's in a very good position to be multicultural and successful.
It's a great time in a sense that New Zealand is actually opening up a lot more. But it is something that everyone have to work on without knowing. Because, for instance, we're just doing a strategic planning for the Africans in New Zealand. And one question we have to keep on working on is that we do not want an African ghetto in New Zealand, which means that the Africans have to be able to get integrated properly within the society. But the families themselves, the way how I was saying that our relationship worked better when Jenny's mom met my family, and we all understood each other. So I will really advise those people to just make sure you always take that step. So you don't just live sometime with a glamour saying I'm this person from this country. Actually get real and understand how it is like in those families because your children belong to both sides.